Hey guys, Booligan here with Booligan Shooting Sports. Today, taking a quick look at my updated Lee-Enfield number 4 Mark 1 Star. This is a Savage number 4 Mark 1 Star, made in the United States approximately 1943. You may recall in my previous video on this, I had purchased this very inexpensively from a local seller, but it had been sporterized. Unfortunately, that meant that they chopped most of the original wood up off of the front, and that means I had to find new wood. I was able to do that through eBay and actually ended up paying more for the wood than I did for the original base gun. I also had to track down all of the other metal components that were missing, including handguard, like caps and joints and things like that, the front sight protective wings. But I was able to track all of that stuff down for relatively inexpensively through Numerich, as well as through another company whose name I cannot remember. And this is why it's a good thing that neither of these companies sponsor me. The finish on all of the metal parts that I received was pretty rough and dingy. Most of it had been stored in cosmoline and still had a lot of that cosmoline on it. So I had to take it, clean it up a lot of simple green and a lot of soaking. And then I actually kind of refinished all of the metal parts using duplicolor engine enamel with ceramic. That's quickly becoming a favorite firearm finish of mine because it's pretty easy to work with. And once you heat cure it in like a toaster oven, it basically becomes very poor man's Cerakote. In this case, I just did it with a low shine black, sort of like their satin black finish. And it goes on quite easy. I've documented this process thoroughly on my Instagram page, and I highly recommend checking that out at Booligan Shooting Sports on Instagram. But for the rifle itself, yeah, I just had to kind of refinish all of these metal components, including the receiver and the barrel. Obviously the receiver and the barrel wouldn't fit in my toaster oven, so what I had to do with those was just to sort of hit it with a heat gun and let it just sit and cure for a while with a heat gun. Not an exact science there, but it is better than just letting it air cure. Regardless, that duplicolor engine ammo stuff does air cure, it just takes quite a while for it to do so. For the wood, the kit that I was able to find on eBay appeared to be a new old stock beechwood set. I kind of gambled and lost with the butt stock. We'll talk about that in a second. But for that, it appeared to be new old stock. It didn't look like it was ever issued or ever really installed on a gun. The stuff was just basically brand new, just a little dirty from storage. So I cleaned it up with some Murphy oil soap. Highly recommend that if you're going to do any woodworking projects, either on firearms or even around the house. Murphy oil soap is awesome. Highly, highly recommended. But just clean it up with that, and then a couple of light coats of Birchwood Casey True Oil to help seal it up and to give it a nice sort of satin finish. That True Oil stuff dries really well when it cures up, and it has nice, I believe it's called polymerization, where it sort of dries to a hard finish other than just oiled wood. So really, really like how that turned out. For the buttstock, I did order a replacement buttstock through Numerich. However, I ordered a walnut one, and when I got it, it was in very rough condition, and the color did not even come close to matching the front. Now, this color doesn't match the front. This has that more milsurp red to it. It happens with some of the oils that are used, the tung oil and things like that. When it reacts to body oils, it just sort of turns kind of a reddish color. Front end does not have that yet. So there is a color disparity between the two, but the stock for this one that came on the original sporterized one was much, much better condition. So that's the one that I went with. I just preserved the paint marks, which we'll talk about in a second, with a couple of coats of True Oil. That way all of the markings and everything are they're not going anywhere because they're under that protective layer of True Oil. About the markings themselves, I was able to research and found out a little bit more. The bottom one is just gonna be a rack number. So this is gonna be some combination of armorer's number, rack number, etc. The top is kind of the interesting one. It says BLR, and I wasn't sure what that meant until I really started looking into it and found out that that means beyond local repair. So at some point in this rifle's history, it was deemed effectively a total loss. Either it wouldn't headspace correctly with the combination of bolts that they have, or something happened with it where it was deemed not safe to shoot. It was deemed not a workable rifle, BLR. What happens with BLR rifles is they're shipped out for storage. They're shipped out sometimes to be repaired, you know, at a more like armor level, as opposed to, you know, a guy boots on the ground level armor. Or in this one's case, I'm pretty sure it was just sort of shipped off to America, and a gunsmith that had a little bit more time at Sears or wherever at the time in the, you know, 1960s, put it together and got it back to safe firing condition. To confirm that, I did check the headspace, and the headspace appears to be well within the safe firing range. So I have no concerns about actually shooting this gun. I believe it is safe to use. So that's kind of how this thing came together. Again, a reminder on the goals of this build. This was not designed to bring this back to 100% factory condition. The goal was mainly to bring it back to factory appearance, or better than factory appearance in some cases. That's why there are some things on it that are a little bit farb, like the finish, you know, the paint finish and things like that are obviously not period correct. Some of the hardware used, the screws that I used here, the screws for these things are about $8 a piece if you can even find them, but you can put in some normal, you know, hex screws and tighten them in and they work great. Just doesn't look 100% period correct, which is a little bit unfortunate, but is what it is. But yeah, the goal of this is to bring it back to being a good safe shooter and still be in that, you know, form factor that it should have for a Savage made Lee-Enfield number 4 Mark 1 star. And I believe that I have succeeded in that goal in general. A couple of things that I still need to do, and I still need to figure out what I'm going to do. You may recall this had a big kind of horrendous scope mount on the side. Those holes are still there, and I need to figure out if I'm just going to put in some set screws to fill them, if I'm going to put in some set screws and then file them flush, if I'm going to try to fill the holes with weld. And it also appears to be missing the ejector screw. Didn't actually have the ejector screw, so we will see. The ejector screw on these is kind of interesting. You don't actually need the ejector screw when you're firing it. There's enough of a drop of mass with the casing that when you eject it without an ejector screw after firing around, it ejects fine. It's usually only need the ejector screw if you're ejecting live rounds, but we'll see. We'll see what I do. But we will definitely hit the range with this as soon as I find some 303 British. And of course, you know, we'll maybe try to have some fun with the spike bayonet that now fits perfectly up front. But yeah, awesome. Love this thing. I hope that returning this back from, you know, a sporterized condition pays a little bit of penance for my absolute butchering of my Mosin Nagant that I did a couple years back when I chopped it down to Trogdor. But I'm getting more into milsurp and into kind of salvaging milsurp that has been poorly sporterized. So you might see more projects like these in the future if you like it. If you like what I did here, please comment below. If you hate what I did, comment below as well, and let's talk about that. Many thanks to my patrons, who will appear in the credits section at the end of this, and of course, many thanks to you guys for watching.